Welcome to UGC lecture series on computer science and software engineering. In this session, we will be discussing about the system analysis diagrams. What is system analysis? System analysis is an active field in which analysts repetitively learn new approaches and different techniques for building the system more effectively and efficiently. The primary objective of system analysis is to improve organizational system in order to ensure that all the components of the system work efficiently to accomplish their purpose. It is a process of collection and interpreting the facts, identifying the problems and decomposition of a system into its components. What are the constraints of a system? A system must have some structure and behavior which is designed to achieve a predefined objective. Interconnectivity and interdependence must exist among the system components. The objectives of the organization have a higher priority than the objective of its subsystem. For example, the traffic management system, payroll system, automatic library system, human resource information system are some of the examples of the system. A system is one wherein you interconnect and interdependency should exist. Next is the properties of a system. First property is about the organization. The organization implies the structure and orderly arrangements of components to achieve predetermined objectives. The interaction, it is defined by the manner in which the components operate with each other. For example, in an organization, the purchase department should interact with the production department. The payroll department should interact with the HR department or the personnel department. The properties of a system gets continued. It speaks about the interdependence. Interdependence means how the components of a system depend on one another. The output of one subsystem is the required by other subsystem as input. Integration. Integration is concerned with how a system components are connected together. The users must know the main objective of a computer application early in the analysis for the successful design and implementation. Now, let us see the elements of a system. Here in this diagram, it has the input, processor, output, and the control. And you are supposed to give the input and it gets processed and you get the exact output based on the input that has been given. So, this processor is being controlled by the controller. And if the output is correct, you get the feedback from the customer. The feedback will be of two types. One is the positive feedback, other one is the negative feedback. Positive feedback makes the system, it says the system works in a very good manner. The negative feedback says that the system has some defects, some flaws available in the system. So again, if there is a negative feedback, it again goes to the input and the process continues again and again. Then from the output, you have the boundaries and interfaces. Boundaries determine the scope of the system. How the system works, what is its scope. So that details about the boundaries and what sort of interfaces are being connected with your system speaks about the interfaces. Then finally, last but not the least, we speak about the environment. In which environment your particular system works, that is a part of the elements of a system. Next is about the types of system. There are several different types of systems available. One is called the physical or the abstract system. Physical system. A physical system has the capability to touch and feel. Physically, it is available, and the desks and chairs are said to be a physical parts of a desks and chairs are said to be a physical system. Whereas this computer is said to be a dynamic system, whereas desks and chairs are said to be a static system. Why it is static and why computers are said to be dynamic. Static system will not move from one place to another. Whereas in the case of dynamic system, a computer has programs. Those programmed computer is a dynamic system in which programs, data and applications can change according to the user's needs. Then is the abstract system. An abstract system or non-physical system or conceptual system that may be formulas, representation or model of a real system. Then the second type of system is the open system or the closed system. An open system must interact with the environment. It receives input from and delivers output to the outside of the system. For example, a system that adapts to the changing environmental condition is said to be an open-ended system. A closed system does not interact with the outside environment. It is isolated from the environmental influences. In reality, it is a very rare case to find a closed system. Then is the permanent or the temporary system. As far as permanent system is concerned, permanent system persists for longer duration, that is, which has the business policies. The temporary system is concerned, it is made for a specified time. For example, a DJ system who has a video jockey who is able to perform a program, and after completion of the program, he will be dismantling his equipment and he will be moving out of the campus. So, such a kind of system you call it as a temporary system. So, these are all real basic examples which explains about the systems, the types of systems. Then we have the deterministic or probabilistic system. A deterministic system operates in a predictable manner and the interaction between system components is known with certainty. For example, two molecules of hydrogen and one molecule of oxygen will give you water. Manufactured system is the man-made system. For example, the spaceships, the rockets, the dams, the trains are all said to be the manufactured system which has been built by man. Then, what is a structured analysis? What is a structured system analysis? A system analysis is also called a structured analysis. Analysts use various tools to understand and describe the information system. One of the ways is using structured analysis. A structured analysis is a development method that allows the analyst to understand the system and its activities in a logical way. It is a systematic approach which uses graphical tools that analyze and refine the objectives of an existing system and develop a new system specification which can be easily understandable by user. Then, let us now see a diagrammatic representation of the system or the structured analysis tools. We have the information gathering tools and we have a data organization, and in the center we have the structured analysis tools. These are the structured analysis tools. One is the DFD, which is nothing but the data flow diagram. Second one is the decision tree. Third one is the decision table. Fourth is structured query, or it is also called as structured English. Fifth is pseudocode. Now, let us see one by one. First is the data flow diagram, the DFD. It is a technique developed by Larry Constantine to express the requirements of system in a graphical form. It shows the flow of data between various functions of system and specifies how the current system is implemented. It is an initial stage of design phase that functionally divides the requirement specification down to the lowest level of details. It is graphical in nature, which makes a good communication tool, or which acts as a good communication tool between user and analyst, or analyst and the system designers. It gives an overview of what data a system processes, what transformations are performed, what data are stored, what results are produced, and where do they flow. So, this is a diagrammatic representation of how a data flow diagram looks like. You have A square, a symbol, which acts as a source or destination of data. These are the arrows, which represents the flow graph, which represents the data flow, either in the upward direction or in the downward direction, or in the, either in the forward direction or in the reverse direction. Then you have a circle symbol, which determines the process transforming the data flow. Then we have an open rectangle, which is nothing but a data store. My dear students, what is a data store? A data store is a place where the data are being stored. A data store is a place where it acts as a database, a place where data is being stored. Let us see the types of data flow diagrams. The data flow diagram, or the DFD, is being classified into two different types. One is called as a physical DFD, other one is called as a logical DFD. As far as the physical DFD is concerned, it is implementation dependent, whereas the logical data flow diagram is concerned, it is implementation independent. Physical data flow diagram is concerned, it shows what are the functions that are to be performed. Logical data flow diagram is concerned, it focuses only on the flow of data between the processes. Next, as the physical data flow diagram is concerned, it provides low level details of hardware, software, files and people. As far as the logical data flow diagram is concerned, it explains about the events of system and data required for each event. And next, as far as the physical data flow diagram is concerned, it depicts how the current system operates and how a system will be implemented. As far as the logical data flow diagram is concerned, it shows how business operates, not how the system can be implemented. Next diagram is said to be the context diagram. As far as the context diagram is concerned, what is a context diagram? Which speaks about the context. Now, the context diagram helps in understanding the entire system by one data flow diagram, which gives the overview of the system. It starts with mentioning major processes with little details and then goes on to giving more details of the processes with a top-down approach. Hope, my dear students, in the earlier sessions, you would have studied about the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach. So, this context diagram works, the processes works with the top-down approach. Then, let us see a practical example of a context diagram. Anything and everything, when you are going to illustrate with a practical real-time example, it becomes easily understandable. So, let us have an example of a hostel canteen management. In this diagram, we have students and the student goes and asks for the payment factors. So, he goes and he asks for certain food items. So, this has been given to the student asks for, or the student makes the payment in the mess management. The request has been taken and it goes to the vendor and they ask and it has been supplied to the mess management. And whatever he eats, it comes as a bill and it goes to the student. So, what are the items needed each day are being maintained by this mess management and this has been governed by the mess manager. So, what sort of overdue payments are pending among the students, or those lists will be available with the hostel warden, who is called as the chief warden, and what are the menus that a particular day will have, and what sort of menu for a particular session will have, will be given to the chief warden, and this will be overall, it will be governed by the mess secretary too, and the mess secretary will have the bills, the overdue of the bills. The next diagram is about the data dictionary. What is a data dictionary? As the name suggests, a dictionary, what do you mean by a dictionary? A dictionary gives you or has a collection of information. So, a data dictionary is a structured repository of data elements in the system. It stores the description of all data flow diagrams, data elements, that is, details and definitions of data flows, data stores, data stored in the data stores and the processes. A data dictionary improves the communication between the analyst and the user. It plays an important role in building a database. Most database management systems have a data dictionary as a standard feature. Then, a data dictionary will be represented like this. First column denotes the serial number, second column denotes the data names, third column denotes the description of those data names, fourth column denotes how many number of characters are required for a particular data name. For example, this ISBN. ISBN will be of maximum of 10 characters. So, that 10 will be listed in the number of characters. Next is the title. As far as the title is concerned, if you are going to write a book, the book title will be of maximum of 60 characters, say for example, then that 60 is being denoted over here. The subject denotes the title of each and every chapter. So, each and every chapter, if it is going to have 80 characters length, then that 80 is being denoted over here. Then the author name, let us say it is very small name or it is a medium sized name, so 15 characters have been allocated. A data dictionary is a place which has all sort of information related to the data. Then about the decision tree. The decision trees are a method for defining complex relationships by describing decisions and avoiding the problems in communication. A decision tree is a diagram that will inform which conditions to be considered first, second, and so on. Decision trees depict the relationship of each condition and their permissible actions. A square node indicates an action and a circle indicates a condition. It forces analysts to consider the sequence of decisions and identifies the actual decision that must be made. So, let us see an example of a decision tree. Let us consider a real-time example again with respect to a clothing store, and that too exclusively with respect to a billing counter of a clothing store. Here, let us consider a customer comes in, he purchases some clothes for his family. Now, he goes to the billing counter, he pays the bill, and the shop, if he is a frequent customer, the shop gives him some discount of 5%. If he has made a purchase for more than 10,000 rupees, then the shop gives him an offer of 5%. And if he is a regular customer, then again they give an offer of 5%. And if he uses a finance type of payment, then again they give an offer of 5%. Or else, if you are new to the store, the shop does not give an offer. So, that is determined in this decision tree. Here, these C2, C1, C2, C3 or the customers, wherein here either they get a discount of 5% or else they do not get. Y denotes they get a discount of 5%. N denotes no, they do not get a discount of 5%. C2 is nothing but if a customer said to be new, but for new customers, as I said, there is no discount, but with a clause, he has made a purchase of more than 10,000 rupees, then he comes under the category of C2. So, if a customer purchases clothes for more than 10,000, then he has to be given a discount of 5%. Then, if not, there is no discount. Then, he goes to C3. In C3, if he is said to be a regular customer, again, they give a discount of 5%. Or else no discount. So, this diagram denotes a decision tree. Next is about the decision tables. A decision tables are a method of describing the complex logical relationship in a precise manner which is easily understandable. It is useful in situations where the resulting actions depend on the occurrences of one or several combinations of independent conditions. It is a matrix containing rows or columns for defining a problem and the actions. Now, let us see few components of a decision table. There are four different components of a decision table. One is called as a condition stub. It is in the upper left quadrant, which lists all the conditions to be checked. Next is the action stub. It is in the lower left quadrant, which outlines all the actions to be carried out to meet such conditions. Third one is the condition entry. It is in the upper right quadrant, which provides answers to the questions asked in condition stub quadrant. Fourth one is the action entry. It is in lower right quadrant, which indicates the appropriate action resulting from the answers to the conditions in the condition entry quadrant. Now, the entities in a decision table. What are the entities of a decision table? The entities in a decision table are given by decision rules, which define the relationship between the combinations of conditions and courses of actions. In the rules section, let us take the same old example of making a purchase from a clothing store. Here, let us consider few decision rules. Let Y denote that it is said to be the existence of a condition. N denotes the condition which is not satisfied. A blank space, let it denote the action used, let that be ignored. Then an X or a check mark will do. Against action states, it is to be carried out. Now, let us consider the same old example of a clothing store, payment made in a clothing store. So, let us see how it works in a decision table. Here, in this table, we have the advance payment made. As far as rule 1 is concerned, for 5% discount, yes, if an advance payment has been made, 5% discount has been given, so yes. As far as rule 2 is concerned, no. Rule 3, no. So on and so forth. Then, if the purchase is more than 10,000 rupees and if it is said to be a new customer, then even in the case of new customer and if his purchase is going to be more than 10,000 rupees, then rule 2 applies, wherein yes, he will be eligible for getting 5% of discount. Then again, similarly for the other rules. Then as a third condition, if he is a regular customer, then even if he is not purchasing for more than 10,000, the rule applies and it becomes yes. And if he is not a regular customer, then it becomes no. What are the actions now? So as far as the action is concerned, if he is eligible for discount, then you give the discount. Yes, give 5% discount. If he is not eligible, then do not give the 5% discount. So, that has been described in this decision table. Hope, my dear students, you understand this decision table pretty well. Now, the next diagram is about the structured English. As the name implies, structured English means the English, whatever has been written, it has been in a structured form. It is also called as structured query. A structured English is derived from structured programming languages, which gives more understandable and precise description of processes. It is based on procedural logic that uses construction and imperative sentences designed to perform operations for action. It is best used when sequences and loops in a program must be considered and the problem needs sequences of actions with decisions. It does not have strict syntax rule. It expresses all logic in terms of sequential decision structures and iterations. A structured English, or it is also, this example shows not only a structured English, it is also similar to a pseudocode. If the customer pays advance, then he is eligible for a 5% of discount. Else if the customer purchases for more than 10,000 rupees, then we need to check whether the customer is a regular customer. If he is a regular customer, then again he is eligible for a discount of 5%. If not, that is else, there is no discount. So you are closing the if conditions, and you come out, if the customer is not paying any advance and if he is not having and if he is not said to be a regular customer, then there is no discount at all. So you close all conditions, you come out. So you such a way of writing it is called as a structured English. Even pseudo code you write in a similar form. Let us see a pseudo code now. So as far as a pseudo code is concerned, a pseudo code does not conform to any programming language and it expresses logic in plain English. It may specify the physical programming logic without actual coding during and after the physical design. It is used in conjunction with structured programming. It replaces the flowchart of a program. Let us summarize. So, you have seen several system analysis tools and system analysis diagrams. So, let us see what are the diagrams that are required and what sort of diagrams can be used for what sort of systems. As far as the first thing is concerned, we have seen on DFD. What is a DFD? A DFD is data flow diagram. A data flow diagram is being used at a high or low level analysis for providing good system documentations. Next is the data dictionary. A data dictionary is used to simplify the structure for meeting the data requirements of the system. The third one is the structured English. A structured English is used when there are many loops and when the actions are said to be complex. The fourth one is about the decision tables. Decision tables are used when there are a large number of conditions to check and when the logic is complex. Next one is about the decision trees. Decision trees are used when the sequencing of conditions is important and if there are few conditions that are to be tested. So, when we are going to use the decision table and decision tree, remember to use or to have the decision rules. Hope you can have it, you can take the example of the clothing store and you can link it with the decision table and the decision trees. So, these are few of the references that are quoted for your further study. Thank you.